Hello and welcome to the episode 172 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today, among other things, we have a supporting gig, a peculiar visit, and three glorious studio sessions. On the 21st of June 1961, as usual, the Beatles were on the stage of the Top 10 Club with Pete Best on drums for their ongoing second residency in Hamburg, West Germany. 1 year later, the same lineup performed at the Tower Ballroom in Wallasey for a night organized by NEMS. In fact, the night marked the first attempt of a new strategy by Beatles manager Brian Epstein to improve the visibility of the lads. The Beatles shared the bill with Bruce Channel, a top act who had recently scored a top 10 hit with his recording of Hey Baby. The Big Three, the Statesman, and the Four J's rounded up the bill. It is not clear whether the move was intended by Epstein as a way for the lads to study a more accomplished act, or to give the idea that the Beatles could support people like Channel with such an authority that they could even steal the show. Anyhow, the evening was significant for another detail. The harmonica skills of Delbert McLinton, performing with Channel, impressed John Lennon so much that the latter's playing of the instrument was positively affected forever. Years later, Channel maintained that McLinton taught Lennon some riffs that ended up in Love Me Do, but this claim is baseless. As you might have heard in episode 157 of this very podcast, the Beatles had already recorded Love Me Do on the 6th of June 1962, and while the piece was re-recorded after this gig, John's harmonica playing didn't change in any significant fashion between the two recordings. In 1963, the Beatles played the Odeon Cinema in Guildford. In 1964, they flew from Sydney, Australia, to Wellington, New Zealand, where they were greeted by 7,000 screaming fans. Before they took off from Sydney, though, they received a visit from a Peter Roberts, a 20-year-old Liverpoolian living in Australia, who had decided to go and say hello, climbing the drainpipe for 8 floors to reach John Lennon's room. The Beatles were quite amazed at the feat and gave Pete a drink. Incredible what fandom can do, right? And it's also incredible what you can do if you decide to make the difference and lend me a hand to create more and better music-related content. If you fancy doing that, please head to www.simonmas.com/support and check out the many ways in which you can make me feel that you care. Donations, shares, album shopping, commenting, whatever you do, will make me feel less alone in this. Thank you! On the 21st of June 1965, the Beatles had a day off in Paris, France. It was probably today, in their George Sank Hotel suite, that they gave their last interview to Chris Denning for Radio Luxembourg's The Beatles series. You can find more information on that whole deal in the very first episode of What a Fab Day. In 1966, we get a long day in Abbey Road. In two sessions from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. and from 2:30 to 6:30 p.m., definitive stereo and mono mixes were produced for Here, There and Everywhere and For No One. Stereo mixes for Love You Too, which was also edited down in its final form from the three existing mixes, and I Want to Tell You, and mono mixes of Dr. Robert and Taxman. Then, from 7 p.m, the Beatles started and completed She Said, She Said, the last song for the Revolver album. Originally called He Said, He Said, the piece recounts a tense conversation between John Lennon and actor Peter Fonda about the merits of LSD trips. The Fabs rehearsed the song for about 25 times before making the first attempt to record it. Once the tape was rolling for real, the rhythm track was completed in 3 takes, although Paul McCartney walked out of the studio due to a heated argument during the recording, forcing George Harrison to substitute him on the bass. The session was wrapped up at 3:45 a.m. with three mono mixes of the song. In 1967, in the afternoon, Paul McCartney was interviewed by an ITN reporter about his relation to Life magazine that he had taken LSD. The news had broken a couple of days earlier, as detailed in episode 170 of What a Fab Day. Paul confirmed the information during a 2-minute, 14-second interview that was broadcast in the 8:55 p.m. ITN bulletin that night. Roughly at the time when the interview was taking place, between 4:30 and 5 p.m, All You Need Is Love was mixed in mono at the EMI studios. The job was repeated between 7 and 11:30 p.m. with the Beatles in attendance. An acetate of this second mix was given to Derek Burrell Davis, director of the BBC Outside broadcast team, for the 25th of June satellite event. The first was used as a reference for the scoring of the orchestra for the live performance. In 1968, while Paul McCartney flew from New York to Los Angeles on Apple Corps PR duties and set a nasty precedent, spending quite a bit of company money on presents for employees and partying, the other Beatles were at the EMI studios in London to complete Revolution 1 and 9. Between 2:30 and 9 p.m, a brass section was overdubbed onto the existing track of Revolution 1, with Derek Watkins and Freddie Clayton on trumpet, and Don Long, Rex Morris, Jay Power, and Bill Povey on trombone. Their parts replaced and deleted existing effect loops. After a reduction mix, George Harrison added a distorted lead guitar part on the song. Later in the evening, after superimposing another sound effect loop on the master tape of Revolution 9, the two Revolutions were mixed in mono and stereo. And that's the end for today's episode. Among the stories that are awaiting for you in tomorrow's offering, there's a heroic early gig from Laurie and the very first Beatles recording session. Are you fab enough to tune in for this and more? We'll find out. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.